example, and some, you know, monarchs, for example, famously had physicians teaching them that. But it was known that the use of opium could lead to death. And there was much written about trying to identify what conditions the person would be in overdose. But there's nothing much that they could do. But there are writings about, you know, trying to keep a person alert, for example. But the concept of like the chronic dependent individual being a problem for society, we have lifespan much shorter. And the expense of creating the substance that's used is so dear and difficult and quite valuable that I think the conditions back then were much different than now also. And the need for wide-scale avoidance of dependence is a concept that probably wouldn't even have been valued back then. After all, and David, didn't Alexander the Great regularly offer opium to his soldiers to help fortify them for battle?
Absolutely, and I was saying before we went on the air that's one of those things that people it's been a bit of a controversy. But you take opium, which was essentially the aspirin of the time, a very strong aspirin. He studied with Aristotle, who knew all about opium, and then he went off to battle. He got wounded about 7 times, but that might be, you know, historical exaggeration, but wounded seriously, and we think he didn't do opium for the pain. It's nuts. And yes, wine and opium were a great way to fortify people for battle, just like amphetamine was great in World War II to fortify pilots. And in Vietnam, it's how guys just dealt with this and women dealt with this incredible craziness they've gotten thrown into.
Yeah, that's a good point. If you're in a society where there are mass deaths and major percentages of the population are dying from smallpox, or you're dealing with flooding and famines, then opium addiction is not very high up on the list of concerns. It's maybe 200 or 300 on the list.
Yeah, okay, since we're talking about Avicenna, you know, because I have no memory left at my age, but not because of opium. I was looking back at the book, and it says that Avicenna identified more than a dozen signs of opium overdose and how alcohol could magnify the danger, regardless what the person developed: respiratory distress, cold breath, and cold sweating. He said death was almost sure to follow. So he got it. He got overdose back then.
Yeah, David, I'm just kind of marveling at the fact that, you know, actually in today's military, in the United States, sometimes soldiers are given Provigil, modafinil, as the current quote-unquote go pill. And I'm just kind of marveling, thinking, wait, so that strategy of upgrading the performance of our military actually is a strategy that started with Alexander the Great. So
yeah,
he still has war significance millennia later. That's
right.
Incredible.
They're not above giving him human growth hormone either if they think it's going to help, whatever it takes.
Yeah, so that's another universal. One thing that kind of, when we're talking about this medieval period, there is something that changes. It's not specifically with opium, it's with hashish, but I wonder if this change affects opium, and here's what I'm talking about. Earlier, when you mentioned Alexander giving his troops opium and others consume it, the use of this drug, it's something that somebody does, but their identity isn't necessarily a drug user or a drug addict. The way that we think of a person, their identity is almost co-linked with drugs in our terminology. But there is a little bit of a change that happens in the Middle Ages with hashish consumption. And there's a term in Arabic, I think it's hashashi, which means a hashish user, but it also has a meaning of just rabble, lowlife. And that's where, from what I understand, the term assassin comes from, that hashashi, this, you know, rabble, lowlife, and the Nazari, this Shiite Muslim sect, were called assassins because they were referred to as this rabble, that maybe they use hashish, maybe they didn't, but that was just the term. So all that to say, drug use isn't something that one does, but it becomes an identity of who someone is. Does opium have also this type of change in understanding where one's identity becomes conflated with opium use and addiction at the same time, or is that separate from hashish?
My favorite story in the, in the ancient Middle East or east of there, there was a famous old man on the mountain myth that Marco Polo came across, and this guy was trying to defend his little territory from invaders from other Muslim sects, Islamic sects, which he also had one. But what he did is he drugged his young men, defenders, with opium, had them seduced and regaled by beautiful women, and they thought they had died because, of course, they're in that religion, there's that myth of the virgins that await you upon your death. And so then they came to, and it's like, wow, how do we get this to happen again? It's so great. And he said, well, you do whatever I say, which included, you know, fighting to the death to defend him.
Hey, everyone. Scott here. We're going to take a very short break for a word from our sponsors.
And yeah, speaking of Marco Polo, with this period after the Mongol conquests, the Silk Road kicks into high gear. There's trade between China and Europe in a way there had never been on this scale. So does opium hitch a ride on all the trade that's going between China and Europe?
Yes, it begins to, but not. Europe was trying to get into China already around 1000, and they really had trouble getting into China. And the thing about China is that's not where the good opium was. You know, they had a very mild variety that they used in medicine, but the really good stuff as it was from Turkey. And so it would be taken more to there rather than brought from it, which is always, you know, again, that Western myth that continues for the next 1,000 years, that all our drug problems come from the Far East when actually they come from us in the Middle East.
Yeah, and I think this is where we're really getting into the modern era and the modern leg of this story. With what happens in China in the 19th century with the Opium Wars and Lindsay Zhu's destruction of Canton's opium in 1839, can you walk me through what's happening in China in the 19th century with international trade and their compulsion to produce opium and all that?
Well, I want to go back a little bit in the 18th century because it's illustrative for going forward. In 1729, the emperor prohibited the operation of smoking houses and possession of opium for anything besides medicinal use. And at the time, 13 metric tons of opium arrived from Bengal province alone. You know, and then by 1800, there were 200 to 300 metric tons. And then in 1813, it was punished in China by beating offenders 100 times. In 1820, they were subject to the death penalty. And right around the same time, 347 metric tons arrived in Canton. So that's sort of the background for what happened, that the British had worked their way into India and ended up essentially colonizing the opium-growing regions. So they had all this opium, just oversimplified. They had all this opium. China had all this tea that they wanted back home. So the British, to keep the balance of trade, needed the Chinese to be addicted or stay addicted in order to keep the balance of trade working. And they had gotten addicted by Portuguese sailors who started years before, who started mixing it with tobacco, which is another early form of smoking. I just gave you 200 years of history in about, you know, 2 minutes, but you're probably used to that. So.
Yeah, I mean, that's always, it's difficult to untangle that type of stuff, but this is useful to know. That's a good launching point into, I think we're talking about the modern issues that we're dealing with, the international drug war. And from what I understand, then opium is coming to Britain as well. In Sherlock Holmes, I think it mentions his, I don't know if it's opium addiction or morphine addiction, but...
morphine, right, John? 7% solution. What, cocaine?
Yeah.
I can't remember which it was. It's cocaine, right?
Remember Confessions of an Opium Eater.
Right, that's De Quincey. Yeah, he was opium. I think Sherlock Holmes was cocaine. Not sure, you know?
You could get all sorts of things in apothecaries back then, so it could be an interesting tonic.
If you look, you just mentioned apothecaries. If you look at, like, in the 1880s in the United States at apothecaries, what are the most common substances that are being compounded with? The most common were opium, cocaine, and cannabis.
Right. That's right. That's right. And, you know, I have a book that was written, you know, I live in Vermont, and it's a book called Green Mountain Opium Eaters. This is an entire book, you know, 150 pages, about people eating opium and a big social problem in Vermont in the 1800s. And a lot of times, because people came back from the Civil War addicted. Soldiers came back because that had been given to them.
Yeah, I wanted to look into what's happening in the United States. Opium use is initially outlawed, I think, in 1914. But until then, what's happening with opium consumption in the United States, and what causes the nationwide law against opium to be passed in 1914?
Well, first I'll say we'll get to the 1914, which is actually more of a tax act than an outlawing. But essentially, it was a racist tool. I mean, it was a tool for racist law enforcement, you know, to deal with the Chinese immigrants who smoked opium instead of taking it as an elixir in refined Victorian circles. So when you say that, John, I mean, it was essentially that was when it began being a tool for racial profiling.
Well, considering that laudanum was given to even Thomas Jefferson on his deathbed.
Right. Right.
Was dependent on it because he had persisting dysentery. And so, you know, the constipating properties of opiates, something I could have mentioned earlier, actually was a very good medicine then, when a person could be losing fluids because of diarrhea. And so it was used as a medication, importantly, since the founding of our nation. And importantly so, things changed hard with the immigration of primarily Chinese and their spread across the country with the building of the railroad. And it's a great example, actually, of how history repeats itself, right? Because, this issue of drug control became a proxy for dealing with inherent racism in our policy and communities.
Do you have a sense of how these laws that are ostensibly written to target Chinese immigrants are enforced? Is it a case where locations with large communities of Chinese immigrants in the West Coast, let us say, then there'd be enforcement? But if we're on the East Coast, and you mentioned that Victorian and Edwardian culture used opium in these tinctures, then there'd be no enforcement whatsoever. Was it like that, or was it something different?
I think it was a lot like that. I mean, those Victoria, that a lot of that opium was still coming from Turkey, especially on the East Coast. And the Chinese, it was in society, but it was the Chinese who were punished for it. And essentially, it was depicted as them corrupting our, you know, fine young men and women of the West Coast. San Francisco was a real hotbed, as it were, of that situation. And the first laws, like there was a law, for example, at one point that opium could be used or imported, except for smoking opium, could not be imported by Chinese. So the Chinese were just finding an American. It's like the modern times, we'll find an American to import it and then give it to them, you know? So they started getting around these partial laws way back then.
And is this before the nationwide law against opium use or the tax is passed in 1914?
Yeah, and once the tax is passed, it's called the Harrison Act. It's kind of a funny law, because if you were going to dispense opium legally, you know, which everyone did, including veterinarians, you had to pay a tax. And one of the most interesting things about it is a doctor could get it to treat pain, but he could not legally get it to do opium. John will have to explain this better. Opium maintenance doses, and or heroin maintenance doses. And this went all the way up to the Supreme Court, who finally ruled, yes, it was illegal to prescribe maintenance doses of opiates to, you know, addicts, which is, John can talk all about that.
So it is without a doubt one of the more bizarre laws. And some of what David is describing there also then is reflective of the evolving understanding of addiction as it within the disease model. Nobody wanted to take ownership of this problem, and that still is a major issue to this day, with not enough providers and not enough beds and a system of treatment that is confusing. Is it a criminal issue? Is it a health issue? Is it both, and how? And how is that figured out? And why, you know, to the point of, you know, drug courts, we have prosecutors and judges playing doctor in a way. So it's still something that our relationship